You done? Good morning. Welcome to church. We're glad you're here today to worship with us. I've got a few announcements. First one is the altar flowers. Oh, hold on before I do. In my welcome. If you're a visitor, there's some yellow cards you can fill out, and there's blue cards you can fill out for prayer requests. And then just drop them in the offering plate. So our flowers today are given. There's two real pretty ones. The first one is for in honor of Judy and Sid Pickup for 2 years of Wednesday night lessons and fun. They here? And then the other one is given by the Mannings in celebration of Scott and John Allen Manning's birthday and Raylene and John Allen's 62nd wedding anniversary. Wow. Now let's worship. Today's reading is from Psalm 24. I wanted to give you a side note. This is from the NIV, and there's a couple places that end in Selah. And in our small group, we learned that it could mean a couple things. One is it's a musical interlude, and another one, it could mean to just stop and think about God. So, Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. The world and those who dwell therein, for he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the rivers. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false and does not swear deceitfully, he will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek the face of God of Jacob, Selah. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and lift them up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. Selah.
Thank you.
As we approach this time of offering, please bow your heads for prayer. Holy God, you love us so deeply that you pursue us relentlessly. You sent your Son Jesus into the world that we who were far off would be brought near to you by his blood. We offer our gifts to you knowing that we can never outgive you, never balance the equation. You don't desire balance, no quid pro quo, only that we find the peace you desire for us, whose foundation is in your word and whose cornerstone is Christ alone. In that holy name we pray. Amen. Please join me now in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you. Children, come down. You may be seated.
We don't have a joke today. Sorry. No, we're not going to make one up. That's Brother Dan's thing. That's not Miss Chrissy's thing to do jokes. Okay? Joke is that Miss Chrissy is here and not going to be very nervous doing this. Okay. So, have we had a good week? Yes? Yes? We've had a good week? It's the first day of the week. It is the first day of the week. So, what's happening right now? We're in church. We're going to school soon. So does that mean summer vacation starting? Are we halfway through summer vacation? We're more than halfway? We're halfway? We're more than halfway? Okay. Well, we've got a month left of summer vacation because y'all start school August 14th. So we got a month. I'm glad you're excited for soon. You start the 24th? Okay, you have a little bit longer. Okay, well, guess what? Today's lesson, Brother Dan's not here, right? He's on vacation, right? So guess what? Today's lesson. No, he's not in Florida. He's at his house. He's at his new house. He's probably not really on vacation. He's probably working, but he's not at work. So you were in Florida. Yes, you were in Florida, right? So today's lesson is talking about how we have rest and how we sometimes all need rest. So you just got back from vacation, right? Where'd y'all go?
So Florida.
You went to Florida? Did y'all take a lot of pictures?
Yes.
I saw pictures of you parasailing.
Yeah.
Yeah. You got stuck in a tree. You couldn't get down from the tree. Did you have to call the fire department?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, a jet ski floated out into the ocean.
Oh.
Because it was out of
tree. Or she just got down. Carson, Austin, have you gone on vacation yet? Yes, where did you go? You went to Florida too? Everybody's gone to Florida. You haven't gone to Florida? Carson, have you gone on vacation? Where did you go? You went on a cruise.
It's still out of Florida.
It's still out of Florida, so y'all still went to Florida. Okay. Well, so Miss Chrissy's kind of going on vacation next week. She's got to go to Oklahoma for class, but I'm not at work and I'm not in Texas, so does that kind of count as a vacation?
Kind of.
Kind of, right? You went to vacation? It's where you're relaxing in the sun, not working. Well, I'm not at my work job, so I'll be okay. Okay, so we've talked about vacations, and we've talked about why we all sometimes need to go on vacation, right? Because we need rest, right? So did y'all know that even Jesus took vacation, and his disciples took vacation? Where? Well, what was Jesus' job? Do y'all know what his job was?
The heavens and the earth.
To make the heavens and the earth, that was God. And then when he sent his son on Christmas Day, Jesus came and did all of our teachings, right? He stayed in his mama's house for 20 years. Listen, if I could still stay in my mama's house sometimes, I would like to stay in my mama's house and not be an adult, okay? So stay in your mama's house as long as you can, but then you have to go to be an adult. The king didn't want him alive. Right. Okay, I am glad that y'all do pay attention during Sunday school sometimes, because y'all are letting me know that y'all do pay attention, because sometimes when Brother Dan talks to y'all, y'all sit there and act like y'all don't know what he's talking about. So this is reassuring to me. Okay. Y'all do it most of the times? Y'all just try to make me look bad sometimes? Yeah, okay. No, okay. All right, so let's finish. All right, let's finish. So, okay, so Jesus, they were out and they were talking and they were working and they were praying for people and telling the stories and telling everybody what Jesus was here for and what he did, and they were tired. So they went up to him, all of his helpers, his disciples went up to him, and they're like, Jesus, we're tired. We need a rest too. They told him straight to his face probably. They probably just said, Master, we're tired. We're so tired. We've done all you're doing, and there have been so many people coming and going. We haven't even had time to eat today because we're so tired. Could you? You have to eat? Yeah. Have you ever been working so hard, though, that you just forget what time it is?
No, but when we were on our way there, when we were on our way back to Texas, we were in Florida, and we were starving.
You were starving? Oh, and Mom didn't feed y'all. Oh, yeah. Man, you poor things.
We stopped at McDonald's.
Y'all stopped at McDonald's, of course. Okay, so Jesus told them, come with me to a quiet place so that you can get some rest. So they got in a boat, and they went away with Jesus to a quiet place. So even when we are maybe on vacation for work, or we are not going anywhere, but we're taking vacation, we just rest. And we need a rest so that we can be refreshed and ready to go for the new week, so that when we run into other people, we can do like Brother Dan tells us, God's going to put somebody in our path, so we have to tell them about Jesus, right? So, as we're finishing up our summer vacation, remember, even though we play hard and we want to have all the fun we can, we have to still take time to rest, okay? So, let's say our prayer. Dear God, thank you for work.
Thank you for work.
Thank you for play.
Thank you for play.
Thank you for school.
Thank you for school.
We also thank you,
for
all those times, when we can get away from all of it and get some rest. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's go to children's church. Children's church.
Of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story.
Well, good morning. I would like to tell you that today is Johnny and Patricia Adams' anniversary. Years. I wasn't even born yet. 52 years. You are an angel, Patricia, that's for sure. Thank you. That's awesome. Well, we come to the time in the service where we ask God to intercede in our needs as a church, as a people of God. So would you please bow your heads with me? First of all, I would like to read these. That Red Wisnant, who sits right over here, is going to have surgery on July the 18th. He's having some medical issues. Also, would you continue praying for Bill Morgan, who had shoulder surgery about a week or so ago. And that this morning, Sue Stahl had to take Richard to the emergency room in Kaufman. We don't know why, except he just wasn't feeling well. So if you will keep Richard and Sue in your prayers, please. And now let's go before the Lord in prayer. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we beseech you to turn your face upon us, to extend your mighty right hand, and shower those that have been mentioned this morning with your blessing, the blessing of healing, and especially the blessing of peace that comes with no understanding, Father, of how you do it. But even in the midst of the darkest time, you are able to turn the lights on so we can actually see the problem, to understand it, to have it pass through us, and have us move on to victory through your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we lift you up. We honor you as the giver of everything, the creator of all that we see, all that we have. And we dedicate ourselves, Father, to your plan that includes victory for this world. We especially thank you, Father, for the special prayer that your Son gave us as we recite it now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Morning, church family.
Good morning.
If y'all know the words to these songs, I invite y'all to sing along. If y'all know some of the choreography to some of these songs, I also invite you to do that too. Let's have fun and worship our Lord. Every move I'm making you. You make me move, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in you. Every step I take in you. You are my way, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in you. Na 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 na. Waves of mercy, waves of grace. Everywhere I look, I see your face. Your love has captured me. Oh my God, this love, how can it be? I lift a name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. Jesus, you came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, and from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift a name on high. Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns.
are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. You are holy, holy. Are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. My days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord on the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel. Lord, to give up I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God,
actually pursue your true calling. Amen. I mean, fantastic. Well, the old saying is that when the cat's away, the mice are going to play. So we got rid of the preacher for a week so we can have a little fun. Yeah, I guess he can watch this on TV at some point, so we better be halfway nice. So he asked me if I'd be willing to do the service, and I said, sure, I'd be glad to. And then, of course, the smarter half of the Underrunner duo says, you know what you really ought to do? You ought to see if Ricky Smith would be willing to come and speak to you. And just understanding when the Lord speaks like that, I'm going to follow it. And I called Ricky, and I said, we would really like for you to come and be a part of our worship service here. I first met Ricky somewhere between 15 and 18 years ago when Sharon and I went into the prison for the first time in 2005, and then for all the times that Leroy and I went and Mr. Jackson and I went and all of these wonderful Kairos volunteers from other churches who are here today went, and Ricky Smith was always very present in the experience that we had within the walls of Beto Prison. And he taught me a whole lot about what it meant to be a Christian under pretty difficult situation. And the beautiful thing about Ricky and I was that as the time got closer and closer for him to be released, it turned out that he decided that he was going to stay in this area. And so it's been fantastic to be able to see him, to see as he has continued to mature, to grow in his faith in Jesus Christ. And he's also a fairly talented man with his hands, so, you know, take that into account also. So it's my pleasure to, just because you guys have supported us in Kairos Ministry since 2005, I just thought it would be a great idea for you to see some of the fruits of your labor, your prayers, your gifts, your cookies for over all these years. And so, ma'am? Oh, the placemats that the kids have done for all the years, the meal tickets you paid, all these things that you've done. One of the culminations of it is in a man named Ricky Smith. And so it's my pleasure for you to have Ricky Smith come and speak to you today.
It is an honor and a pleasure to be here this morning at First Methodist Church of Mabank. When Tien and Sharon asked me to come speak, he offered me 2.5 hours, and I told him I could do it in 2. He invited me, told him I could stay within the time constraints easy. I'm thankful to be here today. There are many heroes of the faith in here that came into prison while I was there for 21 flat years from 2000 to 2021. Sharon and Ken came in, Richard and Linda, Bob and Annette Jenkins, Cooper and Mark and Tina. And I've known them for many, many, many years. I came into the system in Amarillo, Texas, and for 2.5 years, I was inside, and everything that I was doing outside, on the outside that brought me to prison, I continued to do those same things in prison. And in 2003, I signed up for Kairos, and like most of the men, if you've ever ate food inside a Texas prison, you wouldn't feed it to your pet, I assure you. It is pretty rough. And so when they talk about free world food coming into a prison, my mind as a convict was, I'm going to go down there and use those folks up for their food, and I'm going to come back and continue to do the things I've been doing. And so I went to Kairos on that Thursday, and by Friday, God was God revolutionized my life, and I went back to the wing, and I got down on my knees, and I said, God, where do I go from here? And I picked up a Bible, and I began to study. And I began to study. And I began to study. And I picked up every book I could put my hands on to learn the things of the things of the Word of God. I left. I was there from 03 to 09. I did a hardship transfer back down this way to get closer to my mother in 09. And God immediately began to plug me in to ministry on one of the roughest units in Texas, the Bido unit in Tennessee Colony, Texas. And so I became an inmate pastor on the faith-based wing. The wing is our housing where we live. It's three tiers, 198 men on each wing. And I begin to do that. I ended up in the Kairos band in 2011 playing the drums. I ended up in the Spanish band playing the trumpet. I was in a craft shop. I ended up getting three associate's degree and walked away with my bachelor's. I'm gonna just tell a real quick story. When you ask people, let me say this. I have become a Kairos volunteer for 2 years now. I've worked four Cairo since I've been out going back inside. Last Friday night before last, I was at Bido for Faith Base. I was there for Cairo's yesterday, ministering to the men. And my message is this to them. What you do day in, day out in this prison, you will continue to do when you get back out on those streets. And if you don't think that's so, just continue to do the crazy things you're doing in here, because what you can get in the free world, you can get in prison. They have it all. God put that on my heart to go back into prison and begin to minister to those men. I'm gonna tell you a real short story, and then I'm gonna get into the message. Bob Jenkins. From, I guess, 2010 to maybe 14, 15, over the faith base. And we live on a maximum security prison to where when you come back in the day room, your back goes to the wall, and you watch constantly because you do not know what's going to happen. And so we would go to the chapel to have pastor meeting with Bob, and Bob got comfortable there, and we would have lay-ins, and we would come down to the chapel, and we would wait for count to clear, and we'd come down, and Bob was waiting on us. Well, you would come in the chapel many times, and Bob wore a cowboy hat. And when we walked in the chapel, and there was classes going on, probably 180, 200 men in there, Bob would be asleep on a table with his cowboy hat over his face. And I'll never forget that. But when Ken asked me to speak, I prayed about it. And I want to talk on the prodigal son. And a lot of people will think, well, I've heard the prodigal son. Yes, you have, but you haven't heard it in 10 minutes. And that's about how much longer I'm going to speak. When I first started teaching on the faith-based wing, I got really deep in the Bible, and I was teaching what you call a hermeneutics class. And I would talk for 2.5 hours. And I finally figured out not only did the guys get tired of listening, God got tired of listening. So I began to learn as these heroes of faith that are in this building today begin to show me how to love and how to present myself and how to speak and how to say quality words and not a bunch of quantitative words. And so it began to move me along to where God was calling me to allow to love men right where they're at, because these volunteers loved me right where I was at. Okay, in the 15th chapter of Luke, there are three parables. There is 100 sheep, 1 out of 100. There are 10 coins, 1 out of 10. And then there are 2 sons. When I look at this parable is not about the prodigal son. This parable is about the prodigal sons. Not the prodigal son, but the prodigal sons. So I'm going to pick up at 15:11, the parable of the lost son. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had 2 sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided the property between them." Number one, the young man was telling his father, "Could you hurry and die so I can get my money?" The other thing is, in those times, the older son got a double portion because he got the father's portion. So when the father gave this son his portion, he gave him 33% of the estate. So when it says he divided, that's how that is. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set out for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When I was in prison, if you made a commissary, you had a lot of friends. But when your money dried up, they disappeared. Now, I really want to point out something here in the 17th verse. It said, but when he came to his senses, or when he came to himself, implying that he was out of his mind. Do you know men that go to prison are out of their mind? They have not come to their senses. What, I don't say this. One of the things that I learned in prison is we need them. We need prisons. So when he came to his senses, he was out of his mind. He said, how many of my father's hired men have food to spare, and here I am starving to death? I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Here's my question. When was he worthy? When was he worthy to be called a son? Did he say, I want that man and that woman to be my mom and dad? No, he did not. He was a son simply because he was born that. No other reason. We are children of God simply because we have been born again and washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. Make me like one of your hired men. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. And he ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. You know, the father never addresses that statement. He never even addresses it. He just lets it go. But the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his fingers and sandals on his feet. When he comes, I want to say this. When he comes back to his father. His father clothes him, and he's in his right mind. And I'm going to just throw this in here. This won't cost you anything. In 2 Timothy 2:25 and 26, it says that they may come to their senses who have been taken captive by the devil to do his will. Now let me jump over here and I'll finish this up. In the 5th chapter of Mark, when Jesus walks into the tombs, and there's this guy they call Legion that is full of demons, Jesus casts those demons out of him. And you know what it says about this man? He was in his right mind. Do you know men, people that are out of their mind, that need to come to their senses, are demonically influenced? They are demonically influenced, and they need to come to their senses, accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and turn their lives around. But the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him, put a ring on his fingers and sandals on his feet. Bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they begin to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. Your brother has come, he replied. Now he tells him, your brother has come. Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has him safe and sound. The older brother became angry and refused to go in, so his father came out to him just like he went out to the other prodigal son. So his father came out to him and pleaded with him, but he answered his father, look, all these years I've been, look at this word, slaving for you. He has a slave's mentality. He doesn't have a son's mentality. I've been slaving for you. And never disobeyed your orders. He did not understand the grace of the Father. All he understood is obedience to the law. He did not understand grace. And never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But this son of yours, he doesn't say my brother, he said this son of yours. He's rejecting his brother because he's looking at the path he's walking of obedience and slavery to the law. And let me say this. Looking at the Bible as a mirror, he's using it as a magnifying glass and looking like this. But when this son of yours has squandered your property, and comes home, you kill the fat cat. The father said, my son, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. The father's inheritance still belongs to you. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He lost and is found. Let me say this and I'm done. It is understandable. Shows you see on TV, things you see on the phone, the computer, why people do not go back in or don't go in to prisons. It's maximum security prisons. There's some pretty bad things happening. But I am here to thank you as a church for allowing these volunteers that have been in Tobedo for years and years, and they keep coming back, and they keep coming back. They may only go in and there be a few men that they really affect. But when they affect us, we take it back to the block. We begin to disciple other men and preach Christ to them. And just because you see the men in the chapel, there's 4,000 men on the unit zone. And we go back into those wings and blocks, and we begin to minister to men who are lost and hurting. And 99% of them are coming right back to society. 99% of them. So thank you for allowing me to speak here today, and thank you for what you do. God bless.
Please rise. Our hymn of invitation today is "'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus." If you'd like to join the church, I'd highly recommend you probably wait until the pastor gets back. But thank you for coming and joining us today.
Would you like to? Ricky, come up here with you. So I'm going to just ask Ricky if he would just stay up here. Probably is a little easier. And if you would come by and offer the right hand of fellowship to him, we would be very, very grateful. So if you would, please receive this benediction. Take this message. And go out to Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth, proclaim Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Someone out there needs to hear about Jesus. Don't be afraid to tell them your story. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I give you blessings today upon your doings. May God have his grace upon you. Amen.
Amen.